Years 2510, 2669. United Colonies of Mankind.
In a 160-year period, the colonies transformed from fringe societies into developed, prosperous civilizations. The influx of refugees from the central planets, coupled with a rise in birth rate, caused a population explosion. For the first time, the vast mineral wealth of the colonies was exploited to the full. Towns and cities grew at amazing speed. Unlike the opulent, refined centers of the central planets, these were thriving, disorganized and rapidly constructed melting pots, making up in purpose what they lacked in style. The galaxy was an entirely different place for humanity ever since the invasion, but they had risen to the challenge with gusto. This amazing story of rebirth can be attributed to the establishment of a multi-planet federation formed in the early stage of the aftermath, the United Colonies of Mankind. The colonies had charged headlong at an unprecedented level of cooperation and fraternity, driven by overwhelming need to combat the Scourge or face certain annihilation. Few were under any illusions that the Scourge would not eventually find an accurate route to the colonies. This new superstate became strongly militaristic in nature. Armament and military training reached a level not seen since the war-torn 22nd century, although for the first time ever, it was directed against an alien species. New weapons were developed and a state-of-the-art fleet was laid down. This mighty assemblage was newly designed and was by far the largest in human history, and could boast a range of many thousands of efficient utilitarian warships, bristling with the most lethal weapons mankind could devise. After over 1.5 centuries of such progression and meteoric growth, the United Colonies finally felt able to challenge the Scourge and regain their lost homelands. Intelligence gathering operations against the enemy were launched in the later part of this period, and for the first time, humans would return to the solar system and the greater worlds to witness what had become of their former homelands. The first surprise was that this was possible at all, a fact enabled by the continued presence of human full-space nodes on all but one of these systems. This gave the military hope that some form of resistance yet remained on the surface to maintain the portable ground nodes and keep them from enemy hands. Void-based stealth nodes had not yet been invented before the invasion, and all spaceborne types were recently to have been long since destroyed by the enemy. Early and clandestine sorties revealed that a wide variety of human resistant groups indeed exist. Tales from these groups were frequently harrowing accounts of years of torment, hunger, desperation and hardships beneath the notice of their oppressors. However, their many years under the Scourge occupation provided invaluable intelligence for the UCM and shed further light on the true nature of the enemy. The most shocking realization was that many of the Scourge current foot soldiers were utterly human. After this revelation, it didn't take long to deduce that the aliens themselves were gelatinous neuroparasites that could take control of a carbon-based host, bending the victim's action to their will. It also became known that once taken, the host's aging process ceased, their span now tied to the natural life of the parasite itself. It was believed to be roughly 150 to 300 years, as almost all the original lizard-like hosts and their parasites were now dead. As a result, much of the enemy's infantry were now the very same unfortunate souls assimilated during the invasion, and Scourge numbers had not increased much beyond that. It was also immediately obvious that as the Scourge absorb and use the bodies of their victims, so do they use some of the technologies and constructions of the captured race. Expecting to find no trace of their former civilizations, early observers were amazed to discover that most of the useful industrial or military areas of the Cradle Wars on Earth were still in operation, torn or augmented by the enemy to suit their purposes, but still largely intact. Most crucially, the vast orbital installations of these planets were mostly intact. Such revelation gave further hope and purpose to the endeavor, greatly increasing the rewards of a successful reconquest. By this time, the enemy was focused on the construction and dispatch of so-called seed ships, small vessels sent into the cosmos to make blind full space jumps with the intent of seeking new victims to dominate. It was also confirmed that most enemy vehicles and some other constructs were piloted by hostless, pure Scourge parasites, apparently bonded to the manufactured chassis permanently amid the black, tar-like suspension already observed. After these years of intelligence gathering and military buildup, the UCM High Council determined a course of action that would shape the mighty campaigns to come. With the revelation that human resistance remained on the Cradle Worlds, it was concluded that a simple mission of extermination was out of the question. Annihilation by thermonuclear bombardment from orbit would not only deny the UCM the use of the Cradle Worlds in the future, but would also cause unacceptable casualties among the resistance forces. Such an action would be extremely difficult in any case, such was the strength of the Scourge missile defenses. Battle would have to be joined the old-fashioned way, by boots and armor on the ground coupled with substantial fleet support. This would not simply be a war of retribution, but of liberation.